Today our focus is on tachyons, a hypothetical particle that travels faster than light and has an imaginary mass, and even more so on time travel, which we will need to talk about before we get to some of the other subjects like wormholes. Last time, we talked about the basics of special relativity when it came to making time slow down, and we cleared up some of the confusion people often have with that subject before talking about quantum entanglement. Today, we'll be expanding on those notions a bit, so if you haven't already watched the first episode, you should do that now, unless you have a pretty solid grasp of special relativity already. Which is to say, if you've seen these two equations before and used them several times, you're good. Otherwise, not. Now, these equations didn't show up last time, but ought to look fairly familiar. Last time, we talked about distance and time contracting. Today, we're more interested in mass. So we have three new quick concepts to look at. Vest mass, the Lorentz factor, symbolized by the lowercase Greek gamma, and the capital Greek beta. That last one is the easiest. When we are dealing with truly relativistic velocities, we always talk in terms of the speed of light. Something is going 0.9c or 0.5c, and we just use beta for that. If beta equals 0.5, then you're going half the speed of light. Saves time and makes for a smaller equation. The Lorentz factor, gamma, is much the same thing. If you calculate gamma for any given speed, you can just multiply or divide it by your proper length or time to find out how much time is dilated or length is contracted. You can also multiply it by the vest mass to figure out what the relativistic mass is. Now, vest mass is a simple concept but has some tricky aspects. It is literally how much mass something has when measured when it isn't moving, when it is at rest. But we usually don't use non-vest mass, relativistic mass, in favor of just keeping that invariant and thinking in terms of the object's total energy. So we use energy, momentum, and rest mass energy together a lot. This makes gamma way more convenient, but also means we often like to talk in terms of gamma, not beta, since its effects are more intuitively obvious. I mentioned last time that an object moving at 87% of light speed, or beta equal 0.87, would appear to be scrunched up in the direction of motion by half, and have its clock running at half speed, and that one doing 97% of light speed would be condensed down to a quarter, and have time running at a quarter speed. That's the case for gamma equal 2 and 4, respectively, and that's easier to think with. Here on this table, I have selected gammas by their beta value. And as gamma rises, time slows down more and more, and the energy need to get to that speed rises sharply. As you can see, you never quite reach beta equals 1, or light speed, until gamma is infinite, meaning anything with rest mass needs infinite energy to get to light speed. And you need more than infinity, something of a nonsensical concept, to accelerate anything with rest mass over the light speed. Of course, if anything started off with a speed to begin with, like our tachyons, they wouldn't need infinite energy to get there, same as photons don't need infinite energy to be at the speed of light since they have no rest mass. This is where our imaginary mass comes into play. If you pump in a value for beta of more than 1, say 1.41, then beta squared equals 2, and 1 minus 2 equals negative 1. Now we have a problem again because there's no real solutions to the square root of a negative number. That's why René Descartes, best known for I think therefore I am, created what we call an imaginary number, I, which when multiplied by itself equals negative 1. Hopefully you're already familiar with that because I don't want to spend time discussing it, but now it's all good you don't know that the reciprocal of I is negative I. So when we get 1 over I here, we can just replace it with negative I, giving us a negative imaginary gamma and a negative imaginary mass. We don't really care about that negative, and don't usually mention it to avoid confusion with negative mass, which we'll be talking about a lot when we get to the Alcubierre warp drive and stable wormholes, so we usually just say imaginary mass. Now, imaginary numbers bug people, especially in terms of physics, which, unlike math, is only supposed to deal with reality. But imaginary numbers come up a lot in physics, and even trigonometry features them, though we usually hide it. And imaginary mass isn't limited to tachyons, this hypothetical particle now in disfavor. We use it for tachyonic fields for the Higgs boson too. We also use imaginary time in cosmology. Conceptually, the easiest way to explain tachyons running back in time is just to think how time slows down as you approach the speed of light, freezing at the speed of light, and then it just starts running backwards above the speed of light. Tachyons are a whole class of particles, anything which moves faster than light. We don't assume it to be a single particle like an electron. In this context, we also have the luxon, any massless particle like a photon or gluon that travels at the speed of light and experiences no internal time, and the bradyon or tardyon, Tachyon comes from the Greek word for rapid, and tardy is Latin for slow, whereas Brady is Greek for slow, so Bradyon is probably more consistent, but neither gets used much. But a Bradyon, or tardyon, would be any normal metal with rest mass. The application of the tachyon is obvious. If you can generate them, then you can send them back to a given place and time to be received. Time travel telephone or radio, and presumably something you could use to send people back in time too, or homicidal androids. The tachyon was first proposed in the early 60s, though it was known as a metaparticle at the time and soon renamed. It made a couple appearances in science fiction novels in the 70s, but its first use I know of in TV or film was in Doctor Who during the episode The Leisure Hive, whose last installment amusingly was on the day I was born.
Tachyon was first hypothesized on Earth.
That combined with the obvious time travel application of the particle that moves back in time is why the intro for this series has the Doctor Who theme. It's going to come up a lot in the series because there are not many situations where you can travel faster than light without traveling back in time. I wanted to discuss the issue of temporal paradoxes back in episode 1, but I didn't want to run overly long, and time travel, pardon the pun, is a time-consuming subject. Time travel and its paradoxes tend to give people headaches, probably because its use in fiction necessitates it not quite making sense. But today we'll be trying to explain how it works minus the headache. That pretty much ends our interest in tachyons, though. They are simply a vehicle to time travel, and their hypothetical status means we have no proof they exist. They might not exist, and we have no idea how we'd ever detect them if they did. So let's move on to time travel. Fortunately, it's also a topic you are probably already acquainted with. The two classic examples, in terms of paradox, are known as the grandfather paradox and the causal loop. There are some other ones, but they usually represent the same thing under a different name or a minor thematic rather than functional variation. The grandfather paradox is when you go back in time and keep your grandparents from ever meeting, this causing you to never be born, thus preventing you from ever traveling back in time to prevent that meeting, erasing the problem. In terms of alternate timelines or mini-worlds theory, this can have different effects. We'll come back to those in a bit. The causal loop is another angle on the paradox. Causal loops, as the name implies, are where effect precedes the cause, or has a sort of chicken and egg thing going on. An event causes another event, which in turn causes the original one. A loop of cause and effect, or a causal loop. The evil computer intelligence finds itself losing a war with the human resistance, and notes that the leader of the resistance seems to be an abnormally large factor in the loss, and deduces that if he had never existed, the resistance would never have existed either, or been far weaker. So he sends a murderous robot back in time to prevent the birth of said resistance leader by killing his mom. The resistance leader sends his own guy back in time to protect his mom, who then ends up being his father, and forewarns the mother of a lot of the problems. So she ends up raising a kid who is really an abnormally skilled resistance leader, leading the machine overlord to correctly deduce that removing him from play before the game even got started would be the smart move. In the grandfather paradox, you never travel back in time to kill Hitler because having killed him, you erase your motivation to travel back in time and do it again. In the causal loop paradox, you get the chicken and egg aspect. Your time travel ends up causing your reason for time travel. Skynet decides he has to eliminate John Connor in the past, not now, because he has made the resistance so much more dangerous, but the reason for that was because the attempted assassination resulted in him having foreknowledge and training to be dangerous. This is why causal loops are also called retrocausality, pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps, or self-fulfilling prophecies. Now we need to talk about quantum. In quantum physics, there are numerous interpretations of seeming quantum randomness. The two you're most familiar with are Copenhagen and mini-worlds. We don't really have a way to test which is true, if any, because they are all designed to match what evidence we do have. Copenhagen looks at Schrodinger's cat and says the critter is simultaneously alive and dead until you look. I prefer to think of it as a coin that's spinning, simultaneously heads and tails, until you grab it, since I like cats. Plus, I think a spinning coin better represents the concept of an undetermined state. In many worlds, you don't know the result until you absorb it, but it assumes the event actually spawned two different realities. One alive, one dead, or one heads, one tails. The result is already determined. You can't predict which universe you're in, but the contents of the box or the coin flip are already resolved. You just need to check them. Time travel is mostly not a problem in many worlds. If you jump back in time, you just spawn a new timeline. In fact, there ought to be a version of reality right now whereby sheer quantum randomness, various atoms in your front lawn have coalesced into a blue police box and some gentleman just stepped out of, complete with detailed but fake memories of time travel. That's the irritating thing about quantum. Since any given atom has a finite chance to change to another atom, there is a much smaller chance of two of them doing it at about the same time and place, and a far smaller but still finite chance of that happening in many atoms to produce some macroscopic and weird thing out of nowhere, like an individually wrapped candy ball, or a person possessing an entirely random created memory. So in many worlds, there's already a reality in which someone has appeared, genuinely thinking they're a time traveler, even though they didn't exist until 5 seconds ago. This concept is merely an extension of the notion of a Boltzmann brain. In a truly random system, any state that can exist will eventually exist, and that can include a brain, complete with everything it needs to keep surviving, like a body, assembling itself randomly. And that can also include a fake memory, leading that entity and other people to assume they existed beforehand, a concept we'll look at from a different angle when we discuss the simulation hypothesis. But real time travel is nominally viable in many worlds anyway, since you wouldn't even risk a paradox so long as you were jumping to a different time, ahead or behind, in a reality that was not your own. And it needs differ by nothing more than a single random uranium atom in the core of the planet that did decay into thorium and helium 5 seconds ago, in our reality, but did not do so in the one you want to jump ahead in time to. Or a version of the past where an atom of uranium still around now had previously decayed as Julius Caesar was born, and events are otherwise effectively identical. It's not your past or your future you're messing with, so no paradox is created by your actions. You need not even necessarily be moving in time anyway, as a parallel reality might simply have time running there a bit slower or faster, so you're simply stepping into a place that is otherwise identical but a bit further ahead or behind in your own time. In many worlds, it's kind of debatable if going to those other worlds is really the same as time travel or not, but from a practical standpoint, it certainly is. Of course, you could still set up a causal loop in this setup too, though it might be better to think of it as a wave. You get your hands on a time machine, or a reality jumping machine, and wait till the next news report of some big gold strike on a relatively cheap chunk of land, or some other event less random than the lottery, like a new tech patent, and jump back a bit in time into a reality where a copy of you exists waiting for such data too, hand it off to him and he takes off, leaving you there to assimilate into a near-identical circumstance, but now very rich due to your foreknowledge. He arrives the next carbon copy and cuts the same deal with your other quantum clone, and rinse to repeat until eventually some difference exists that breaks the chain, and the wave crashes to an end. This isn't a causal loop in that chicken and egg sense, since you had a definite starting and stopping point. Now the Copenhagen interpretation, that our cat or coin is in two states at once until absorbed, doesn't actually prohibit alternate timelines or realities. It simply has no need for them. There's tons of different ways you can have places besides our own universe, after all, and some of our other FTL concepts, for instance, would involve popping into a parallel universe, meaning one that has bits and pieces corresponding to our own, that was smaller than our own or had a higher speed of light, and just zipping through there until you reach that point of congruity and popping back into our own universe. But again, in Copenhagen, there's no need for these alternate realities, and we often assume there is just a single timeline. After all, an issue with many worlds, an incorrect one but a common concern, is that these branching new realities are all new universes forming from nothing and breaking energy conservation, or giving you something from nothing, which, considering our own universe is assumed to have violated that in the first place, shouldn't be a big concern. But normally in many worlds, or in some variations of it, the assumption is that these alternate universes already existed and always have. Think of it as alternate pasts, not just alternate futures. More than one state of affairs can lead to an identical final result, a concept that relates to our next concept, and would still apply even though it assumes there are no alternate timelines. In the context of the Copenhagen interpretation, with no alternate timelines or realities, or at least where if they do exist they are inaccessible, we have something called the Novikov self-consistency principle. Igor Novikov, who came up with the Novikov self-consistency principle of time travel, argued that temporal paradoxes weren't possible. He closes out paradoxes in time travel, which are permitted in some solutions of Einstein's field equations for general relativity, by asserting any event that would give rise to a paradox or change the past in any way must have a probability of zero. This doesn't ban time travel in and of itself, though. It simply is arguing that any time travel has to result in no paradox, or it would be infinitely improbable to occur. Novikov is arguing that regardless of whether or not time travel is possible, you would not be able to do anything that causes a paradox, in a conceptual sense. Don't think of this as some sort of time guardian who pops out and stops you, but rather that the moment you take a paradoxical route, things would reset to a scenario where you hadn't taken it yet, and keep doing it until you picked a path that didn't cause that. Since in Copenhagen there was always a chance of one random quantum event will spiral itself up to a macroscopic level, one will eventually occur that results in a non-paradoxical action. There's no deletion. Our coin, that can normally be heads or tails, will simply never land on heads, if doing so would cause a paradox. You would not remember these resets, of course. They will have never happened for the same reason that once you open Schrodinger's box or catch the coin, the absorbed reality erases the alternate possibility. And as we discussed in quantum entanglement, that erasure is not constrained by the speed of light, nor does it even seem to care if it has to reach back in time to fix it. Again, this isn't implying anything is selecting that solution that counters the possible paradox. There would be many that did it, and many that didn't, and one would happen same as a drop of water falling from the sky will eventually take a path leading to the ocean, whether it does so by falling right into the ocean, or on your roof and following drainage ditches and waterways to the ocean, or even falling on a desert and evaporating. The self-consistency principle tends to bug people a bit as confusing since it sort of seems like a tautology. Paradoxes are impossible because paradoxes are impossible. But the difference is that it's asserting the laws of physics can't be chucked out the window by time travel. There's a comment on this that the principle seems to permit any type of action allowing anything to be done through time travel except killing yourself, since you obviously can't travel back in time if you're dead. I'd say even that doesn't work though, and something will happen to resurrect you, like one of those freak quantum events I mentioned earlier where a blue police box and a guy with fake memories of time travel is spontaneously spewed out by quantum randomness, or someone discovers Clonian mind uploading, something we'll be talking about in the future. Again, it's not that something is stopping your specific actions, it's just that all your possible states and actions will only be non-zero probabilities when they won't cause a paradox. Now, Novikov's views are hardly considered canon, however, it comes up a lot in time travel talk, so I wanted to discuss it. Same reasoning as the tachyon. Although in the tachyon's case, while it has fallen a bit out of favor in science fiction, it has seen a recent resurgence in all sorts of pseudoscience, especially for methods of immortality. And again, we'll be looking at that subject ourselves soon, though we will be mostly focusing on plausible science. Next time in this series, we'll be looking at the Alcubierre drive, often called the warp drive, and taking our first dip into how general relativity allows us to warp space-time, and another type of exotic matter, particles and fields possessing negative mass or energy. From there, we will move on to wormholes, which rely on many of those same general relativity concepts and negative mass as well. I haven't decided on an exact order to the next few videos since I want to redo the old Dyson Dilemma video, where I'm having to interrupt our regular schedule, but subjects we'll be looking at in the near future, in no particular order, will be a return to the Habitable Planet series for a look at double planets, a return to the Megastructure series for a quick look at hoop worlds, and neither of those are going to require very long videos, so we'll probably be sooner than later. We'll also be taking a deep look at the simulation hypothesis, the concept that we might all be living in a giant simulated universe, and some of the implications that would have in regard to the Fermi paradox, as well as an introduction to the concept of transhumanism and biological immortality, especially the latter's implications to the Fermi paradox. If we get a chance, we'll look into the Carter Doomsday argument and its own implications for the Fermi paradox. And as you might guess, this jump back into the Fermi paradox is a major motivation for finally redoing the Dyson Dilemma, and if I get a chance, the Fermi paradox solutions video as well. So a busy next couple months, assuming I can hold the current weekly schedule. If you want alerts when the new videos come out, subscribe to the channel. And if you enjoyed this video, make sure to like it and share it around for others. In the meantime, try out some of these other videos, and as always, comments and questions are welcome below. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.